My name is Katie. Welcome back to my channel. I am doing my craft videos. I don't really want to call them critiques, but I will be giving you kind of my opinion on them and what I got most from them. So I'm kind of going to take you through what the book is structured like so that you know if it's something that would help you if you would like to purchase it. I'm going to be putting all these book links down below. They are affiliate links, so it just helps me and you and the author, and it's all a win-win-win. But also, if you're part of my newsletter, these notes that I'll kind of be reading off, I'm not going to read everything, they'll be uploaded onto my members' pages. So once you are signed up, just click on over there. You'll be able to download these notes, which is a super condensed version of the books. However, the notes are more so for what I learned and what I got out of it, and notes to make these videos. There's stuff in there that you might need that I didn't mention at all. So I just want to go through. Today is about writing Irresistible KidLit by Mary Cole. And I really like the beginning. I really like the chapter outlines because they actually outline with like a little synopsis beat and then what all you're going to find in there. So even if y'all want to know what each chapter is going to entail to see if that's something that you need, just DM me, find me on Instagram, and I can totally take pictures and send these to y'all so you can see if it's something worth your while. Because again, I'm only going to focus on a few things. So this takes us through, as I was showing you, the KidLit market overview, which I pretty much skipped in my notes. Then it has the middle grade versus young adult mindset, which I mostly wrote down the middle grade because it's the one I was most unfamiliar with. So possibly I will add in the young adult into the notes for the members only pages so that you have both sides of that coin. It kind of seemed like it was more for middle grade, like I took notes because it was more middle grade, you know what I mean? I did a video about middle grade versus young adult back in the day, and I'll link that down below as well and kind of go over a few things too if y'all need it. But the gist of middle grade is that you feel the pull to go, to grow up, to make big choices, be unique, but also the pull to stay, to be a kid, be safe, have things decided for you when the going gets tough all at once. They want to define themselves as an individual, but also want to fit in with their friends and social groups at school. So it's that whole struggle, which YA is like the next level. So the next chapter, chapter 3, is what's the big idea? This is what's going to take you through the originality of your book idea, the commercialness of it, and the hook of it. This gives you your logline slash hook slash elevator pitch, which is the genre, the pro tag, the setup, which includes their goal, and then the problem and hindrance to said goal. And this kind of gives you a logline similar to what you will find in Save the Cat, which I've also done a video on. Chapter 4 is Storytelling Foundations. It covers how to start your story, the inciting incident, the promise of the novel. It covers prologue. It talks about how you balance action with information and delves into show versus tell. This one I was super impressed with. It also is mentioned in Wired for Story, which I will also say in that video. But basically, you want to show your character's emotion, and it goes on to talk about physical telling and how it's cliche if that's all you use. This was such a big brain thing for me. I'm actually coming out with a coffee chat about it because, like, I rely on physical telling so much. And not even externally, but like internally a lot. And I was really like, when I read that, I was like, oh my gosh, my writing is poop. But it's when you don't use the internal, the interiority is what they call it. It's when you don't have access to the character's thoughts, their feelings, their reactions to the situation. That's when it's bad. But when it's all coupled together, it's fine and it's great. But, I mean, don't use the same reactions over and over again. So you basically want to reflect on why they're crying. Show that they're crying, but show why they're crying or why they're angry or etc. And you need the interiority to go with telling or physical telling because that's going to help your reader go deeper and not just read over the surface of that telling. So I thought this alone was super helpful, which again is talked about in Wired for Story. Another thing that is in this chapter is tense and point of view. and also multiple points of view. Chapter 5 and chapter 6 were the most helpful for me. Chapter 5 goes into character, and so it says like the 6 things you need of your pro tag in the first chapter. It says you need your character's worldview, how they think about life, and what their overall attitude about it is. At least one piece of context, a detail about how they relate to and interact with their world. At least one character, objective, or goal, either big picture or pertaining to the scene at hand. At least one characterizing detail that teaches us something about their personality. At least one piece of advice that gives us a hint of their language, energy, and way of noticing things around them. And at least one concrete choice or action, preferably a save the cat moment. All of this in your first chapter is really going to help your reader understand who your protagonist is and care about them for when your inciting incident or even just that conflict comes up in the first chapter or your cliffhanger in the first chapter or whatever. This is all going to solidify your protagonist for your reader. This also goes into the layers of your story, which is like revealing the objective versus revealing their motivation, how they confront changes versus confronting their failures, me versus the world. This is going to add those layers that your reader is looking for. The next thing this chapter talks about for character is their core identity, their core strength, virtue, role, flaw, emotions, boundaries, outlooks, and beliefs. And it's going to go through and help you realize those for your protagonist. And they do that by writing exercises. So this one goes through defining your core identity, your heroic qualities, tough decisions, the outer layer, characterizing reactions, past, present, future, quirks, and private moments. They also caution to give your antagonist objectives and motivations early on so that readers can relate and understand them. They also go through a secondary character worksheet and a villain character worksheet. And they go through a list of questions for each so you can really nail down that character. I don't know if that focused. There we go. And again, if you just send me a message and I will screenshot these if you're interested in these questions or just buy the book. But they also put a scene rubric in here. And it's basically like what you need in each scene, which to me is crazy. Like, I don't even think about all of this when I'm doing a scene. And I hope it's coming inherently because my brain doesn't even want to answer these questions. And it wants you to do it for each character in that scene. So it's just a lot. It makes you dig really, really deep. This book, as you go through, it has things that are like from the shelves, which gives examples from books that are already out there. And it also has a section of like from the authors and editors and their thoughts on the subject as well, and books that they recommend you go check out. In chapter 6, we talk about plot. So that's, they cover plot versus emotional plot and give this graph of how it kind of goes opposite. There we go. With what's happening in the story. And then it just kind of goes into the plot. It goes into the inciting incident, the fall, like everything that's on these charts is what they cover. They don't cover like beat sheet beats or act 3 beats. It's just the very simple, typical, real simple plot. And they caution to have at least 3 escalating conflicts during the fall that your character comes up against before they reach the climax, each getting more dire. This is like the fun and games section, and it's just like, depending on what method you use, I'm like taking or leaving this basically. It's not what I go for, but like my brain does do those things already. And if you're doing like the 3-act structure, you're gonna have those pinch points. It's gonna be everything similar, you know what I mean? Like it's your own, whatever you wanna do. So plot goes into personal versus private stakes. They talk about how tension is more subtle than stakes and how you need that on every page, which also I'm like, I just want to put some banter on here, but I guess there will be a purpose. And they say you can create tension in your description and withholding information in the rhythm of your sentences, like if they're short or long, and then like urgency versus leisure, like what's going on in your scene. They talk about backstory and withholding information. And so if that's something that you have trouble with, in my notes is kind of a little bit of what they say about backstory, that less is more. And then they go into subplot and the muddy middle. And something that they said about subplots is something that I'll talk about in my video of what I've learned from mentors and craft books like as a whole, and that is that subplots are separate from your main story but bound by that big objective or theme, And so all your subplots still need to weave in with the bigger plot, which I thought I did in one of my books, but they were like all separate that I was trying to weave together. But this basically says, like, think of your plot as a web and deepen the connection between your plot and subplots and characters. And that includes your secondary characters, because that's usually who's going to be in your subplots. Then it goes through your climax and your ending and how they need to be presented against their biggest challenge and triumph. And you incorporate your pro tag's core strength to test his core weaknesses. And you're showcasing their difficult moral dilemma, all that inner struggle and journey that they've come all this way for. And I kind of skipped over it, but they do talk about your muddy middle and how to make it less muddy and more like action-y and character driven and all of that, with all your subplot help and things like that. So if that's something more that you need, I would suggest getting this book. Chapter 7 goes into advanced KidLit, and really it's not like advanced KidLit, it's more like advanced writing craft. So it breaks down your imagery, where you want to put those, your setting, and how to like make that come alive, as well as your world building. It goes through voice and your word choice. And what's so cool to me is your author voice versus your character voice. So it's like your author voice is like your brand and style of writing. So like someone could relate like fighting scenes to you. Someone could relate love stories to you. And I think that is so cool that if your reader picked up a book, they could read a few lines and be like, oh, that's this author. Like, I know who that is. And that is like the freaking dream. Like, how cool is that? I love when authors have their brand and they're like, I write Hufflepuff boys and this and this. And I don't know why. That's the only one that has stuck with me right now. It also goes into some voice exercises of how to make your characters distinguished by how they would answer certain questions. And then it goes into theme by what you want your reader to identify with in the book. And it goes through certain themes that are really good for KidLit. The last one is career in KidLit. And this talks about your agents, querying, editors, subwrites, submissions, has links for where to find critique partners, and asks questions to ask yourself for picking agents to query, and has links for agent resources. And it also has a query blurb formula and do's and don'ts of when you're writing your query. So all of that in this like 200, almost 300 page book, it actually was a lot. It felt like so much. One chapter I know is 100 pages long, and it's like broken up into sections, which is great, but I wanted to be like, I'm done with a chapter. And it didn't really allow you to do that, but it did have a lot of from the shelves, a lot of examples. So if you don't need those examples, you can go through this book fairly quickly and just get in what you need. Since this video is already pretty long, I'm just gonna go ahead and link the middle grade versus young adult voice video down below. And as I make the rest of the videos, I'll also be putting them down below. This is the first one of this like craft book series. So I hope that y'all enjoyed it. Let me know if y'all have any questions down below, and don't forget to follow me on Instagram or Twitter. You can even go there to DM me if you have any questions or want any pictures of any of those charts or anything. And then be sure to sign up for my newsletter if you want these notes that are way more than what I could have read in this amount of time. But they're notes that were helpful for me, which will hopefully be helpful for you. But you can even take them as like a template, and when you read the book, add more notes for yourself. That'll be on my members page. So be sure to sign up for that newsletter so you get access to that members page. Again, thank y'all so much for watching. I hope this was helpful. This book will be linked down below along with the other ones, and hopefully these videos are helpful to you on what I think of these books and what I got out of them. Happy writing, and good luck making your writing craft better, and I'll see y'all in the next video.